Worship Sunday here at The Point, which means the room here is full of young lives who will make our day and our worship more fun. So Point kids, turn to the nearest adult now and ask them, are you ready for some fun this morning? Yeah, we are! If today is your first time with us, grab your phone super quick and send us a hello text to 812-359-1799 so that we know you're here. And don't miss our chance to meet and greet you. And kids, be sure to bring your crew back next week when our Point Kids programming is open during both services. Our spaces are designed just for you. And we spend our hour playing games, learning about Jesus, and just generally having a blast together. I mean, it's fun in here, but it's super fun in our kids' spaces. So be sure you come back next week. For all of our regulars around here, thanks for helping keep all these ministries going each week through your generous giving to The Point. Do you need a refresher on how to make that happen? Here you go. You can give on our website at gotothepoint.com. You can simply text The Point Give on your mobile device to 888-364-4483. You can mail a check to 311 Meyer Street, right here in Seymour. And if you're in the room, we have black boxes in the back of the room that you can place your gift in as you leave today. Easy peasy. One other unique thing about today is that we get to share communion together at the end of the service. Friends, communion is a sacred time when these everyday elements, like bread or a cracker and juice, or whatever you have in your cupboard at home if you're joining online, become reminders for us of all that Jesus has done for us and the new life that we get to live right now because of him. If you're in the room and miss snagging those elements on your way in the door, don't worry. Pop out the back and grab those ahead of the end of the service or send a responsible kiddo near you to grab them for you. We'll share communion each Sunday during these weeks headed toward Easter on Sunday, April 9th. On that day, we're adding one service to help accommodate all the visitors, family, and friends we know will attend. Our three services will run at 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11 a.m. Point Kids will be open, like always, during 9:30 and 11 that day. If you're able, would you consider moving your attendance time up a service that day just to help us make room for others? And most importantly, would you begin praying now about who you will invite to fill these seats? This isn't about packing the room for the sake of numbers, and we know that. This is about packing the room for the sake of lives. Lives that need to know the resurrection power of Jesus is for them. And friends, it's for us right here, right now too. In a few moments, Pastor John is going to lead us into week two of our series, Dude Not Perfect. Because perfection and holiness are confusing sometimes and can trip us up, make us feel hopeless. But what Jesus meant when he said, be holy, was really meant to do just the opposite and bring us a whole lot of hope. Whew, isn't that good news? So let's spend the next few minutes singing together. And as we do that, let's let God prepare us for what he has to say to each one of us today. And kids, keep your eyes peeled during the intro video ahead of the sermon. Our very own Point Kids director is part of the impossible shot this week.
Would you stand in this place? Let's worship the Lord today.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore. Every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord.
It's your breath, let's sing together.
It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
Pray. to celebrate today.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you, Lord. It's your breath.
Hallelujah.
It's our lungs.
Proclaim today that He is Lord. Amen. Let's cry out together and celebrate the one who gave us all.
And all the earth will shout your praise.
Come on, church.
Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing and great. And are you, Lord?
And oh, we sing it,
and all the earth will shout
your praise.
Our hearts will cry,
these bones will sing.
Those mountaintops, we hear cries.
won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be for my feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and saints, my heart will still be singing, my soul will be the same. Oh, oh, come on, be magnified.
Christ be magnified.
Full of your
your love will never give up. You said your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me. Yeah. You said I'm saved. You call me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You never fail, so I know that you'll never fail me. Take you at your word. If you said it, I believe it. I've seen how good it works. If you start it, you'll complete it.
Awesome.
Oh, you know what? Hey, Kelly, would you help us with something real quick?
Come on.
No big deal. Take it for a minute. Wait, you're going to need this.
Okay.
Yes.
Right. Impossible shot number two. Here we go.
We got this.
Apple arrow to the head of the children's director.
Yes.
Oh, woo! Okay, here is this is a bow and arrow. All right, you just stick the arrow in there and shoot the thing.
No.
Joel, you turn it around. Like, there you go. You got it now?
We got this.
Okay, good. All right, dude, let's try it again.
We got
better
this.
Form.
All right, we got this.
You gotta pull back a little further. You only went like a foot.
All right, okay. I got it.
All right. All right, Kelly, hold still.
Hold real still.
Very still.
We got this.
We need a pro. You all think that's funny. We needed Jeff that day, man. It was fantastic. And we continue on our journey of Dude Not Perfect. Last week, we talked a little bit, and if you missed it, I invite you to go back, gotothepoint.com. You can check us out on Facebook, YouTube. But we talked about how we have the capacity for wholeness. And I think that's good news, amen? Anybody else excited that God wants you to be whole? Okay, three of you. Okay, there we go. Okay, you guys are going to learn this about me. I do like participation. It's one of my fun things. And so we're going to kick it off like with something really exciting. Now, last week, I do have to apologize for those I nearly killed. If you weren't here, you missed it. It was a fantastic time of dodging and throwing and all kinds of great stuff. So we're going to up the ante today. Does that sound good? You all thought, man, he can't outdo last week. But we have our kids in the service with us today. Let's give it up for our kids. And now, kids, listen. Listen, I want to break the mold of like church being boring. This is going to be a fantastic and fun experience for you. So if you're up for it, kids, what I need is for the kids to come forward and form kind of like a mosh pit down here. You have no idea what that is. Just get in a group, okay? So I want you to get in a group over here. So come on down. You're not going to want to miss this, I promise, because it involves t-shirts, okay? Now listen, children, there are some ground rules. There will be no tackling, elbowing in the face, or biting of any kind. okay? Scooch over this way further, because we need to, like, I'm going to go over here, okay? I'm kind of still in the light here. We got to make it challenging. Go over there, okay. Okay, and like the little ones down front, okay? Little kiddos down front, because I want to give you equal opportunity, okay? So I'm going to throw this, but I'm not going to have my eyes open, okay? Is that okay? Like, this is dude perfect. It's got to be a little hard. So I'm going to turn around, okay? And the first one I'm going to do, should I do it like through my legs or under my arm? Which one?
Through your legs.
Through my legs. Okay, you ready? Yeah. Here we go. You down in front, just be ready. Are you ready? Okay, here we go. Ready? Hey, give it up. We got a t-shirt. Okay, here's one over the head. You ready? I got three. Okay, remember, no biting. No biting. Okay, here we go. Oh, we have tackling. Okay, if you've caught a shirt, you cannot catch another shirt. That's another ground rule. I'm watching you, Robinson. Yeah, that's right. You ready? I can't see anything. Here we go. Through the armpit. Oh, hey. All right, good job, kiddos. Give me a five. There'll be more t-shirts later. All right, here we go. Good job. Give me five. Go on. Now go back to your seats. You don't have to stay up here the whole time. Go on. Good job. High fives. Who wants to give high fives? High fives. There's one. One. Yeah, good job. I got like four high fives in like a span of a second there with that one. Hey, bud. You're like, where's my t-shirt, dude? Duke, I love you, buddy. You can sit there. It's totally fine. Yeah. Man, here we go. And let me say this before we get going. We love our kids and teenagers here at The Point. We believe it's one of, yes, amen. It's one of the most important things that God has commanded us to do, not as just parents, but as a community of faith. Our kids need us to raise them the way they should go. And oftentimes when the world gets a little confused and says, let's raise our kids the way they want to go, we forgot that it's all right. It's okay. Actually, God wants us to show our children the way to him and the way to their best life. Amen? And so we believe in that with Point Kids and our students, and I think it's a fantastic thing. And God is inviting us to take a next step towards wholeness or holiness. Last week, my hope is and my desire is for this whole series is for us to begin to kind of unpack some brokenness that we have with our understanding of what holiness is, and maybe have a new perspective, a new understanding of what it means to be whole, and ultimately what it means to be holy. Because Jesus, and it's echoed back in the Old Testament as well through Yahweh, gives us this command to be holy as I am holy, or to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. They're really scary statements that Jesus and Yahweh make, who is God. But it invites us to this way of life that it doesn't really reflect the life I'm living. Anybody else? We got a bunch of holy people in the room. Yeah. You know, it's hard, isn't it? And I think the reality, when I go back and watch these Dude Perfect guys right on the screen, there's five of them. If you have no context, I'm going to give it to you every week. Here's the Dude Perfect guys. We want to give them props because here's the truth of it. They're the pros, right? They're the ones. They have perfected what it means to make an impossible shot. And when I watch the things that they do, I think, man, there is no way I could tape all day long and not make the shots that they're making. Because they're pros. And I think in the second week, we encounter this encouragement, this engagement with God to come and be whole. We recognize that last week, we have the capacity, if we're made in the image of God, we have the capacity to be whole. And that's great news. But how in the world does that happen? Because oftentimes when I engage this reality of I want to be whole, I come up against this question that I face the reality of impossible things in my life. Like, I want to be whole, but there are some things going on in my life, whether it be brokenness, broken habits, sin, trauma from past events, the sin of others impacting my life. You name it, we've all got it. But there are obstacles that are standing in the way of me being whole, and they seem impossible. And the reason things seem impossible is because they can't be done, like, by ourselves. I have some impossible realities going on in my life. I want to to share something with you that I haven't shared with really anybody other than most people, that I was blessed with my father's inability to be flexible. So, like, I am like a board. Like, there are 2x4s through my legs, up to my spine. It actually goes all the way into my microphone. Okay, good. If that keeps going, I'll get a handheld one. I'm not sure what's happening. Oh, it's on my beard. That's what's going on. See, it's also I'm in perfect. Here we go today. But I'm inflexible. So somebody hold up the number three with your fingers. Like if you went 1, 2, 3. Now, how many of you can actually touch your thumb? Anybody else? So you all see Wanda. She said, well, yeah, because if you can't, then something's weird about you. My children physically, we'll do this like probably on a weekly basis. Hey, Dad, do the finger thing. And I'll sit there and go like this. Like I cannot, my fingers will not touch. They'll come over and force, like break my hand and force my hand. I can't grab my pinky. So now I've learned to do this. I do this little weird, like strange salute to, I don't know what's happening there, but I can't grab my pinky. It's impossible for me. And no matter how hard I try, no matter how much I see all of you irritating people showing me that you can do it, I can't because it's impossible for me. And it reveals, we're going to discuss two problems today. I think the kind of barriers to how do we become whole. Two problems. And it reveals this first one and exposes these two lies underneath that me that impossible things tell me in my mind that I'll never change. And then sometimes I'll relent and say, I never can change. We talked about those last week. We're going to kind of re-hit these two lies. This will never change in me. And lie number two is this doesn't need to be changed, right? And so as we enter into this discussion, we start to navigate the reality of those lies in our lives and uncover problems that are revealed. And here's the first one today. When I face something impossible, specifically related to my spiritual wholeness, my physical wholeness, what God wants for me, I have this problem that I face, that my capacity for change is determined by my capability to accomplish that change. Does that make sense? So when I discern something that needs to change in my life, and I look at it, and it feels impossible, I look at that thing through the lens, through the perspective of what I'm capable of to make that thing change. Does that make sense? So the capacity for change is all just inherently in me. And it makes sense that I look at things and says, I don't have the ability to fix that thing. So then I revert back to those first two lies. Well, I can't change. And then I have to lie to myself because I don't want to feel bad all the time and say, well, maybe it just doesn't need to be changed. You're stuck with this broken version of me, right? But God invites us to a way of life where we can learn to navigate through this problem. And we're going to do that through a story in the Old Testament in Genesis chapter 17. We meet this couple, Abram and Sarai. Now, Abram and Sarai are old fogies, right? They're like old. And they decide they want to have a child. And we read that story and think, man, this is just weird. Why would they want to have a kid, right? And so we're going to enter in this story and talk a little bit about them. And it says this, they weren't quite 100, so they were still a little young. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty, walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. And Abram fell face down, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. And Abram went, bro, I'm 99. Ain't no fathering gonna happen with me. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful, abundant. He's like, there's nothing fruitful about me. Abram's thinking in his head as God is making this vast proclamation of his life. I will make nations of you and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. What a fantastic promise. Doesn't that sound like great news for Abram? Now, let's just get real, right? If you were sitting there and God came down and gave you this amazing promise, and we have it before us today. Hey, I want to make you whole. And yet many of us, again, our perspective about impossibility is that we can't accomplish it because we're looking through our own capacity. And yet here is God making this vast proclamation. And there's so much more in this that we need to see with our non-modern eyes, because there's talks about God making him a vast nation, about kings and rulers coming from him. See, the ancient Israelite, Abram included, for them, their heir was directly connected to their livelihood and abundance in life. If you had no heir, you had no future. Because your family wouldn't be passed along and there would be nothing to give to you, the generations after you. So this vast proclamation of God is really great news to Abram. It says you will have an heir, you will have a future. In fact, I'm even going to give you a new name. I'm going to rename your entire family line to be showing that this promise of God has been activated in your life. And yet, for Abram and Sarai, they had been living for 99 years in the constant reality that their impending future held nothing for them or the generations to come, because they had no heir, they had no future. And yet God said, well, I'm going to move you from no heir to no future to a new name and a new future. That's good news. But Abram, like all of us, and I love the humanity of Abram and Sarai, because impossibility started to kind of bubble up, right? And we move on in the story. God also said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you're no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah, right? And he began to show them this. And we'll go to the next slide. I already said this one. Abram and Sarai, they move from heir to no future. But then Abraham in the story, the next verse, Abraham becomes very human. God gives him this promise. You'll have a new future. And Abram says to this, Abraham fell face down. And what did he do to God? Anybody notice? He laughed at God. Now, let's just be honest. How many of y'all have laughed at God? It's okay. You're not going to get struck down with lightning. Abraham didn't get struck down with lightning. It's the humanness of Abraham. God lays out this amazing promise, and Abraham laughed and said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? You know, like the reality check. Because Abram and Sarai face the same problem that we face. When God gives this vast promise, you're going to have children, you're going to have this huge, abundant, full life, right? When God says to us, you're going to be whole, you're going to be holy, this amazing life for you, we butt up against the reality of impossibility, which we look at with the eyes of what we're capable of. It's that first promise that's the first problem that's uncovered. We only see through the eyes of what we're capable of, what our capacity to face the problem is. And so Abraham had the same issue that we did, right? He laughed and said, no way. And then he did something else, right? This will never happen. There's lie number one. And now the lie number two kind of sneaks its ugly little head up and says, well, it doesn't really need to happen. Watch what Abraham goes on to say. And then Abraham said to God, after he laughed, and said, God, well, you really don't know. If only Ishmael might live under your blessing. I'll give you a little context. Ishmael was a son that Abram had with a slave because he couldn't have an heir with Sarai. And so, you see the first lie sneaking in Abram's life? It's never going to happen, right? He laughed at God, no way. And that second, more subtle but more destructive lie, Abram said, well, it's just always going to be this way, so let's live in the reality of what is. Couldn't Ishmael live under that promise? And I think it exposes something inside of us where we just want to settle. We want to settle for what we can do instead of living in the fullness and wholeness of what God could do. And that's the most tragic reality. When God invites you to be whole and invites you to transformation and wholeness and holiness, and we say, nope, it never can happen, and yep, it's always going to be this way, I believe God grieves. Because he says, no, my child, here's my best for your life, and you're stopping just short of living your best life. Because we settle, folks. How often do we settle for the way things are because we can't imagine how they could ever change? God help us today. And it brings us to this next problem, which I believe is kind of just one step underneath. And Abram, like those lies, lead us to trying to control, right? I think Abram was faced with the impossibility just like we are. It will never change. I don't want it to change. Let's find another way. And really what it is our coping mechanism, I think. And Abram, it came out in Abram, or Abraham eventually. His coping mechanism to deal with a life that where he was always faced with the reality of his own inability to be the thing that God wanted him to be. All he could see was his ability to accomplish this great monumental thing that God promised him. And underneath the surface, what was really lingering, that was most destructive, is that Abram and Yahweh had a trust issue. Because here's problem number two. We control situations in our life. We control our faith journey. We condense it down to nice, neat things that we can do and accomplish. We, in the last 100 years, we've even quantified what it means, how you can be saved, right? Here's the two sentences you can say to get to heaven. And I'm not robbing us of what it means to be saved, but I am saying, isn't it more? And couldn't our need to control even the moment of salvation be a seed of, do we really trust God to accomplish in us something greater than just sitting around in our weirdly maroon seat saying, heaven someday? God help us. What if you didn't have to wait for heaven to experience the realities of heaven in your life right here today? Come on. You say, preach it, brother. You 50 and above folks, I won't call you old. You all want to like stand up and shout it, right? It's not about just the prayer. Like we control because we don't trust. And we don't trust because we don't know. I remember growing up with my kiddos and we loved to swim. And we get in the pool every year. And when they were young, I wanted them to learn to swim so they wouldn't die, right? That's like every parent's greatest gift. I want to teach my kids to swim so they won't drown. And I was taught as a kid how to swim. My grandfather lived on a lake, and so that's where I learned to swim. And my mom said, hey, today, John, you're going to learn to swim. And she brought me down to the dock, and she heaved me into the water. Said, swim. So I had that traumatic moment in my life seared, but I thought like that's the way you teach your children. So I would oftentimes write off the kids would learn to swim and we had this safe, like trusting relationship and they'd be on the ladder and I'd say, hey, Morgan or Marley McKenzie, jump to me. It's gonna be fantastic. I'm here. I love you. You're safe. And then they would leap in total trust and guess what I did? Oh my gosh. The look of, I have to ask forgiveness from the Lord for the trauma that I have caused my children. That I just like, oh, I wanted them to learn how to swim. And Heather swoops in and we had our, this whole marriage thing. Like, no, you got to let them like swim or die, you know. And she's like, no, you don't. You're a crazy man. She picked him up and saved him and kept him safe. And from that point on, it was always weird to me. I would go to the pool again and say, hey, jump to me. This will be great. You can swim now. And they'd be like, uh-uh. I ain't jumping to dad. I'm jumping to mom. And I was hurt, but I was hurt because there was no trust. Because my kids had experienced a reality of me that was opposite of what I was telling them. What they had with mom was that they knew her. And her promise as she stood before them that I will catch you was based in trust. And what did my girls do every time that Heather stood in front of them? What did they do? Anybody guess? They jumped in joy and liberation. Because they trusted that mom was going to catch them. And we need to experience the reality of this trusting relationship. And later on, Paul, to the Romans, writes of Abraham's story of this whole shift. And he gives us another sneak peek because Abraham struggled with the reality of impossibility. He even tried to control it. But eventually, Abraham would enter into a relationship where he would trust God enough that it would change his perspective about what was possible and what was impossible. In Romans chapter 4, it says this, against all hope, Abraham, in hope, believed and so became the father of many nations, just as it has been said to him, so shall your offspring be. And without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead. He faced the fact that he couldn't, in that situation, make what God promised happen, since he was about 100 years old and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver, which is interesting, Paul's perspective, looking back, thousands of years. Like, he did not waver. Yeah, he did, Paul. Like, I don't know what story you read. But he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God. But I think it shows the fullness of that entering into relationship with Yahweh that Abraham had. But was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he promised he would do. This trust relationship where we begin to settle in that I can't, but there's a God who promises, who can stand, and I can trust his promises that I could be whole, that you could be whole today because God promised it. And it's God's desire. We even see in Genesis chapter 17, it goes right at the beginning. We jump back. What God is echoing this reality to Abram, even from the start, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. This word blameless here is be holy. And what do we know holy to mean, church? Everybody say it. 1, 2, 3. We got three of you. It means to be whole. Ready? Say it. 1, 2, 3. Whole. To be holy means to be whole. Blameless, perfect, pure, whole. God was echoing it from the very beginning of his relationship. Walk with me. You notice he didn't say, keep walking your life under your own power. He said, walk with me and you'll be whole in your life. You'll be whole if you walk with me. It's this relational connection that builds trust, that says to us in my heart and in my mind, I can believe what God promises he says he'll do in my life. Because he can't. Or he can when I can't, right? He enters in. And the real question, and I want this to shake your soul today, because it's only fair, it's been shaking my soul all week. Sometimes God works in me. I want to share that with you. The discomfort. Do you know God well enough that you trust he will do what he promises? Maybe you're here today and you're like me. You grew up in the church and you said the two-sentence prayer and you thought, check the box, I'm done. Do you know God well enough to trust that he'll do what he promises he'll do? Are you walking with him so that you can discover the truth of what it means to enter into the wholeness that you have the capacity for, that he created you with the capacity for? Do you know him well enough? And what does it mean to journey into that relationship with him? So I said, Lord, how do you do this? And I think Abram said the same thing. How do I accomplish blamelessness in walking before you? And I think we find it in Abram's reaction. And I don't think he even knew what he was doing at the time. But how to be holy? How do we be whole today? Because it feels impossible. We can't do it. And it says in Genesis 17:3a, the beginning of the verse, Abram fell face down, and then God said to him all those things. Abram fell face down. Now, anybody know what that posture of falling face down is all about? To me, it's about surrender. Surrender is the entry point, the journey of wholeness for you and for me. That's our point today. If you leave here with nothing else, leave with this point. Surrender is the entry point to wholeness. I haven't experienced wholeness in my life. I haven't experienced wholeness. I'm a broken, complete mess, and I can't. Well, today, God is here to tell you, follow me, walk with me, know me, love me, let me lead you, and let me do what you can't. Because the truth is, what you can't do, God can do today, amen? And he wants to call you, church, to say, stop waiting for heaven, but experience the realities of heaven right here and now today in your life and mine. What if that could be true? Where we could know that we know that we know, that we trust that he is a God who will do what he promises. And every moment you enter against and you come up against the reality of what you can't do, you can look to him and surrender and say, God, there's another one. There's another one. You look at your broken relationship. God, there's another one. You look at your marriage that's about to be failing. God, there's another one. You look at that pattern of addiction in your life that you keep on returning to no matter how hard you try to fix it and change it. God, there's another one. I can't, I can't, I can't, I can't. But walking in relationship with him, he invites you to live into the truth, the promise that when you can't, he can. And friends, that is not something you can just get in your brain and learn about. It's something that we have to experience today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we enter now into this moment of mystery. God, where we know and we've seen, and everyone here, Lord, something has come up in their minds as we've talked today about what's impossible. Whatever scenario, situation, brokenness, habit, hurt, hang up, whatever it is, we face the reality of our own inability to accomplish any sort of wholeness or holiness that you call us to. And God, that is the point. We can't. Pray those lies from the enemy to keep us in that place of brokenness, believing that it will never change or we don't need it to change, that we can come out of the darkness and into the light today. And just like Abraham, Sarai, and people from across human history, we can find the secret to entering into the wholeness that you've created us for all along and fall face down before you and surrender and begin our journey towards wholeness and discovering that you are a God who will follow through and do what you say. Help us, God, to discover that in the mystery of experience, God, today. I pray this in Jesus' name, amen. We're gonna do something different. Would that be okay? Y'all get a little tired of that eventually, I'm sure. But we're going to receive communion. And normally communion is done in kind of an introspective sort of way where we pray and we thank God and all that he's done. But I want us to enter into this new perspective, because I feel like today is all about new perspectives, that God is a God who says, I will do what I promise. And we have the great opportunity to have eyes that look back 2,000 years ago and see that Jesus came, Jesus lived his life, showed us what it means to be whole. He died and was broken and rose again to show us what a life of wholeness really looks like. Amen? And the good news about that perspective is we can look back and say, and we don't say this with hearts of introspection all the time. We don't look back and say, oh, praise the Lord. God, you can't, or you can, but I can't. You know, that's wonderful. But no, we can celebrate the reality that God does what he says he'll do. Amen? Okay, so we're gonna practice this a little bit today. I want you to stand on your feet, okay? Everybody stand up, and you got your communion with you, okay? Jesus, on that day 2,000 years ago, he looked into his disciples' eyes, and he said, hey, take this bread, and we're gonna break it, and this is my body broken for you, so that you could take it into yourself every meal of every day and experience the great mystery of this profound faith that we have that God and us are one. Jesus said, I want you to abide in the Father as I and the Father abide together, that we can be made whole today through the body and blood of Christ. And as you take the bread, this little cracker out of the thing, take it out now. And we're gonna receive communion today in a spirit of celebration, amen? Because that's something to celebrate, that where I can't, God can, amen? And that today we receive the body of Christ broken so that we could be made whole. Let's receive today in celebration. And he picked up the cup and he held up this wine. He said, this is my blood poured out for you. I'm gonna give all so that you could become all that I created you to be. I love that. It's like the last little portion to fill our cup all the way to overflowing, to add his part so that we could be who he made us to be, amen? And we can look back 2,000 years ago and say, look, God actually did what he promised he would do that day. He poured himself out so that we could be made whole, amen? We receive the blood of Jesus today together to be made whole. God, we celebrate. Lord, what a gracious promise that where we can't, Lord, you can. Let us stand in that wholeness today as you make it possible. Amen. Let's worship him.
Broken inside me.
Yes, he does.
And just one touch, you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. And just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My can't help but believe there's nothing that our God can do, church. There's not a mountain that he can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do. Oh, there's nothing that our God can do.
Do you believe it today?
A prison wall he can't break through.
Give him praise. Hallelujah. Oh, we believe today. Amen.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let's all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let's all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let's all agree.
believe that today, that there is nothing that our God cannot do. Perhaps you've heard that message today, that message of holiness, to be holy as He is holy. And where you find yourself in your life right here today, in that moment, you think, there is no way. There is no way. And yet we've heard from Pastor John this morning the truth of the scripture. We've heard what only God can do. And I got news for you. If he can cause a man that's 100 years old and his wife that's nearly 190 something years old to conceive, and that he would birth nations and kings and generations and make them fruitful, I have to believe that he's got your holiness and mine under control. Amen. I believe that today with my whole heart. And so I want you to leave this place knowing that through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you can be made whole. Amen. Amen. May you go from this place today. Give him praise. That's good. May you go from this place rejoicing and praising our God for what he has done. And before you leave, one thing I need to remind you of. There were orange cards. We love our kids. You saw a whole herd of them up here. We had enough pledge to take care of all of those needs, which is amazing. Absolutely amazing. We need those orange cards back. Okay, so make sure if you have not put the amount of money you pledged in that orange card and returned it or done that online, we want to make sure to just keep that before you. We want to say thank you for investing, but make sure you get that orange envelope back here to the church office, or go online and do it there. So thank you. Go in God's grace and God's love and God's peace. Church.